now is talk about the kerosene product line. Jerry mentioned it before. We have K75, although it's not pictured, there's a K125, then a K175, there's a K210, K400, and a K650. And all the number after the K means the BTU level. And if you go to the tab, that is called Tradesman K. Tradesman K will see the sell sheet. It gives all the good what there is to know about kerosene product. Then if you open that, get past that front, that page, you're going to see the English owners. English owners. Printed off, there's English and a French for the smaller heaters. After that, there's a K400 and K650 owners. We'll discuss the differences in just a little bit. All right. Well, it costs more. But there is less maintenance associated with it and less of fees. You can also use number one, number two, the fuel oil, diesel. In fact, what we got right here, I got some off-road diesel. Works very well. We'll demonstrate when the time gets to that point. Those fuels are dirtier. They burn a little bit dirtier. You get more smell of them. You probably have to increase the ventilation rates a little bit because of the extra smell now that you're getting with the number one, number two fuel oils. Obviously, this is preferred, but that was also used for burning. Controls. All of these heaters are electronic ignition. Here's an electronic ignition controller. I just took off the side panel of the heater where there's the on-off switch. It shows the electronic ignition controller, which has a built-in thermostat that monitors the operation of the product. It includes the thermostat and a room sensor. Now, the manufacturers made some changes to this over the last couple of years. At this point, when you see that red circle, there used to be two little male pins coming up. And then there was a remote room sensor that was located right here. It was a little bitty bulb. It had a couple little wires that went back and connected to this male pin right here. Well, the manufacturer of the circuit board got rid of that. So we're not going to put that on there. Okay, well, what are you going to give us? Well, the circuit board now has a built-in group sensor. It's part of the circuitry of the board. You're not going to find a little bulb with long wires connected. Well, I got an older heater, and I'm getting this board. What do I do? I'll put the board in, make all the other connections that you did, and you know that that's the room sensor wire that you have. Throw it away, because it's no longer needed. This will register what the temperature is now for the heater, which feeds back information to this into the little display unit, identifying what the temperature is. So that was a change right there. That happened probably, you know, a few years ago, somewhere in that happened to work. So supplies voltage to all the various components in the heater. When this heater first starts up, you're going to hear that ticking sound, real fast, real strong ticking. And that's the igniter. That's the igniter sparking. And the reason that the igniter is sparking first is because you don't want the fan motor to be turning before the igniter is sparking. In this style heater, I'll dissect it a little bit. You have a carbon rotor. And if that motor is turning before the igniter starts sparking, you're pulling up raw fuel and spraying it into the combustion chamber. When the igniter starts sparking then, after the motor starts, you're going to get a whoop while the flame shooting out. And there's going to be liquid spilling out of the nozzle end of this heater. You don't want that, so the igniter has got to be sparking first. If there is a problem with the igniter, which I'll show you in a little bit, you're going to get liquid atomized fuel springing up. If there's no ignition. Remember on the Tradesman 400s, there wasn't that igniter sparking? If you don't have the igniter, that's gas. That's one of the beauties about it. Gas kind of dissipates. That heater is blowing that air out. So it dilutes that gas so you don't get an explosion. Right? And liquid fueled heaters are a little bit different. If that igniter isn't sparking, and that motor is still running, you're still pulling up liquid fuel out of that tank. And that liquid fuel isn't going to get ignited. So it starts puddling in this combustion chamber. Then it might start puddling back here, leaking down inside. Although kerosene, like Gary talked about this morning, a lot of people are starting to look at kerosene heaters because of maybe code requirements or something in your area where you can't use propane anymore. It's nice from that perspective, but you've got to make sure that that igniter is sparking before it starts pulling raw fuel out of that pump. If not, you're going to get fuel puddling, you can get fire burning down inside this combustion cone where there isn't supposed to be any fire, right? So be aware of that. If it doesn't ignite, what I tell people over the phone is, you're going to get some puddling. Turn that heater up a little bit and sop up as much of that kerosene as you can. Give it a towel or something, because if you don't do that, you're going to have a little bit of burner flame or flame in general where you don't want to see it. So, questions on that? We're very good. You're the clicker. Okay. All right. Next item, we have a fuel filter. And a fuel filter, I've got a tight down in here, but this is the nozzle right up in here. There's a orifice holder, a nozzle holder. And there's two rubber lines that come down. One will go back to the pump and pull it over a little bit. The other one goes to this fuel filter, which is kind of tightened into the tank right here. And that fuel filter will have like a real fine mesh type of fabric screen on it. This is one style of filter. It's used on the K75 through the K210 here. The 175 is not on the head with the cover pulled off. Now, I don't have a K400 or a K650 up here. Just not enough room. K650 is bigger than that thing, so you can understand why we don't have it. But a filter designed for those products, this is out of the owner's manual. You find the same illustration in the manual. There's a tank fuel filter that looks like this for the small ones. And then there's a tank fuel filter that will have something similar to this. It'll come up with two copper lines that attach to the pump section. One's a supply and one's a return. As you can see right here, this is the supply line going through the pump. This is the return from the pump back to the tank. So it basically does the same thing, just a bigger version, slightly different version is all it is. Questions at all on that so far? Filter's a filter, no matter how you look. Can it get plugged up with crud? Yes, most certainly can. We don't change, let's say if, from a maintenance perspective, I left all the old fuel in the tank one season with the next. Well, now I've got some crud floating around. Maybe there's some particles and so forth. Well, the job of this is to strain that stuff out before it gets either to the carbon, or excuse me, to the nozzle or up to the pump. That's what that's for. So you can take this out. We can take these out, loosen these compression fittings, and there's a little bracket right here on the 650 or 400. There's a rubber grommet that gets pushed down into the top of the tank. And those brackets hold that grommet in place. On earlier design K400s and 650s, we had a problem where there wasn't a bracket put on by the supplier. And people would get these and say, I'm here around. I got kerosene sloshing all out of the end of this tank. What's going on up here? Right? Let's take a look at it. So drop the things back. Sure enough, this rubber product right here popped loose. The movement. in the real world of construction site, you're not going to drain the fuel out of the tank and then move it. You're going to try and pick the thing up before it hits. Well, with the fuel in the tank, what happens is that it can move. It can kind of move against that filter that's popping up, that grommet. So we made a service bulletin that said, all right, people, here's what you do to correct it. Take it out and rebend the lines, push that garment back down maybe with a blunt tool so you don't pop the rubber. Oh, and by the way, manufacturer, you got to correct that. We were talking about some of the things, Dirk, before some of the changes. This is one of them, K400-650. You got to go back to the manufacturer and say, you guys, this is a problem right here that you need to address. So what they did is they said, hey, we got this bracket, we're going to put that in production now, because we need to hold that grommet back down. We've got to keep that thing on and up. That was one of the things that we as a user, if you want to call it that, had to tell them as a manufacturer, this is what you got to make. Because in the real world, they're going to be moving this stuff around. So we were charging and we're talking about some of the changes that were covered with the